back in the old days, in the sort of golden age period of Zen, which was about 1,000 years ago, the spiritual seekers used to travel from teacher to teacher, trying to find an entrance into the truth. When they arrived at a new teacher, they would go in and ask a question, and the questions were quite stereotyped. A very common one was, "What is Buddha?" The word Buddha means the one who awoke, the awakened one. One time, a monk came in to Master Joshu, one of the greatest of the old Zen masters, and said, "What is Buddha?" And Joshu says, "The one in the hall." And the young guy says, "Yeah, but that's just a lump of stone." And Joshu says, "That's right." And the young monk says, "So what is Buddha?" And Joshua says, "The one in the hall." So the historical person, the Buddha, was around 2,500 years ago, a really long time ago. We are now, and he was then. And really, for nearly the last 2,500 years, there's been this sense of this person, the Buddha, who seems to have been, you know, historically attested, although, you know, there's been a little bit of debate even about that, whether he even actually existed. But this idea of somebody who woke up, getting further and further into the past. And so, with that disappearing in the rearview mirror, the question becomes, well, what about this awakeness right now? Is this whole thing about some guy who's really long dead and getting, as I say, further and further in the past? Or is there something else? One of the ways that this kind of problem got dealt with over the centuries was to kind of turn it within. Okay? This historical person was a long time ago. But what about that within you right now that is already awake? That's another dimension of this awakeness. Nothing to do with history. Right now. All of us very likely are not completely perfect people. We're all kind of works in progress. But there's a dimension within you that's awake now. How would it be if you allowed this awakeness, this which is absolutely fully alive, fully engaged with this moment, how about if you allowed this dimension to have its play? When people really started to get serious about realizing that the historical Buddha was this person disappearing into the past, a whole bunch of texts appeared which were essentially about meditation methods for meeting the Buddha in a vision or in a dream and receiving these teachings of this awakeness or from this awakeness in a visionary kind of state. And the historical Buddha, they called the Nimanakaya, this Buddha that you could meet in vision or in dream, they called Sambhogakaya, which means bliss body. Now, You don't even need a vision. This awakeness within you is already fully alive. All we need to do is, as it were, step into the place of this awakeness. In many ways, when we adopt the position of meditation, the physical alignment, the mental alignment, the breathing alignment, it's like you're lining yourself up with your awakeness. You're taking the position of awakeness. You're taking the Buddha position. You're not only sitting like a Buddha, you're sitting as a Buddha, the Buddha that you are in this moment. Now, when you really come into this moment, not only do you come into this moment, but so does everybody else and everything else. The way that your senses are working, the way that your mind is working, is such that it's not much different the way a thought runs across your mind as the way a car running across your hearing sense outside runs across your mind. The thought, the sound of the car, it's all one. All your internal experiences and your external experiences can be one. You, from this perspective, are not some little blob of skin in a great big hostile universe. You are exactly the same size as the universe. You form one body with the universe. When you come to sit in meditation, you come to let go. When you let go of the tightness, of the closure, of the feeling of me against the world, then automatically and naturally you form this one boundless body with the whole universe. Because the universe couldn't be here without you. You and your universe are one. And this boundlessness, this one body, is also considered a Buddha body. The Dharmakaya, they call it. So while the actual historical person 2,500 years ago is ever receding into the past, this awakeness of the moment, this boundlessness of the moment, right here, right now, is a place where not only can you meet the Buddha, but you already are the Buddha. Now, the motivation perhaps behind this old question of what is Buddha is the fact that the entry qualification really for becoming a Buddhist, somebody who follows in this way of awakening, is to take refuge. To take refuge in the Buddha, to take refuge in the Dharma, to take refuge in the Sangha. Now the Dharma, what does that mean? It means the truth. It means the teachings of the Buddha. It also means reality, the reality of things. The Sangha. The Sangha means the community, other people who are also doing their best to orientate themselves towards the truth of things. Taking refuge. There's a very famous Zen master called Dogen from Japan who says to take refuge is exactly the same as when a child, when a little girl throws herself into her father's arms without the slightest doubt that she's going to get caught. When you can throw yourself into your place of meditation like this, without worrying whether you're going to lose anything, if I let go fearlessly, when I throw myself into my practice like that, when you do that, you're taking refuge. When we do this, when we take a refuge, when we let go, when we throw ourselves into our awake place, that doesn't mean that our limitations and our humanity completely vanish. You and your uniqueness continue. You and your history continue. There's only one you in the whole universe. You are absolutely unique. When through that wish within you to take refuge, that wish within you to throw yourself into your truth, when you do that, when you follow that, when you allow that impulse to have its play, it's completely normal for your humanity to show itself. That's that feeling of limit, that feeling of maybe I'm not good enough, or that feeling of I'm jealous of her or I'm envious of him, or all of the human stuff can start to show its face. And then we can start to think, well, I'm not possibly a Buddha. How can you have an envious Buddha? It's impossible. How can you have an angry Buddha? How can you have a grieving Buddha? But actually, there's another way of looking at this. When you take refuge, when you allow the possibility of your truth, your awakeness, to be right here, right now. All these things that show their face, the frustration, the anger, the impatience, the regret, all that stuff, you can view them as also wanting to share in this awakeness. All you have to do is just give them space. Don't take them seriously in the sense of buying into them or identifying with them. Just allow them to arise within this open space, this acceptance, this presence. Lo and behold, they begin to transform. They begin to shift, to change. You realize more and more clearly that you're not a slave of your past. Every single one of us has made mistakes. Every single one of us has done stuff that we're not proud of, maybe stuff that we wouldn't want anybody else to know about. Maybe we've been harmed by others. Maybe there's regret about that. Maybe there's grudges about that. But if we just allow this stuff to arise within this openness, this awakeness, this spaciousness, not pushing it away, not holding on to it, then it can all liberate. It can all come free, little bit by little bit. Now, maybe you might be carrying 5, 10, 20 years worth of stuff that needs to kind of release. Now, the beautiful thing about this work is it doesn't take 20 years for it then to release again. But it may take some time. And this stuff doesn't happen in the abstract. It's only as it arises that that regret can release, that that fear can release, that that anger can release. So just because this stuff is arising doesn't mean you're doing anything wrong. It might well mean you're doing something absolutely right. You just provide this safe, awake space. And then whatever unfinished business there might be, up it can come. And week by week, day by day, being willing to come back and provide this awake space, this Buddha space, this space of acceptance and kindness and generosity, then all of the stuff that's been carried about can start to release, come free, and you can become more and more unburdened. You can become more and more free, more and more alive. And you can know more and more fully how a beautiful gift that your life actually is. The sheer magnificence of this boundlessness can become more and more yours. Now, perhaps the most important Zen master in China was called Enno. And he taught his students that ultimately to take refuge in the Buddha, to take refuge in the Dharma, to take refuge in the Sangha, is to take refuge in yourself. But to, when we say yourself, who you really are, to be open to the possibility of your full aliveness and awakeness, and to plunge yourself into this like a child throwing themselves into the arms of that loving parent. We can all do this. So we're going to do some walking meditation, but before we do just a little more chanting together. If you take your sheet again, there's a four-line verse we chant together.
Shijamu henze gan